بسم الله الذي لا إله سوى الواحد الأحد الفرد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته الصالحين الغر الميامين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله صلاة تنجينا بها من جميع الأهوال والآفات وتزكينا بها من جميع الأهواء والشهوات وتطهرنا بها من جميع السيئات وتقضي لنا بها جميع الحاجات وترفعنا بها أعلى الدرجات وتبلغنا بها أقصى الغايات من جميع الخيرات في الحياة وبعد الممات. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. كيف حالكم؟ عبد الجاب. What did we do last session? In summary? What was the summary? One or two lines of last session? That I have to. It's true in your itikaaf, you do lose track of time. But you shouldn't lose track of content. You lose track of time. Alhamdulillah. Don't know which day it is, but we should keep in mind track of content. So, the idea of being the doorman, the doorwoman to my heart, the importance of stationing myself, looking at those beautiful words of Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani rahimahullah, kun bawaballahi innabari pandit. Become, as a full-time profession, the doorman, the guard of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the door, at the gate of your heart, and make sure that nothing enters your heart. Emotions, feelings, ideas, images will accept that Allah loves it. And do not allow into your heart anything that Allah would be displeased with. And that this, to an extent, is a consequence of muraqabah. That is, that when I'm aware that Allah is watching me, when I'm aware of that, even mentally, then I don't want Allah to see in my qalb what He doesn't love. I don't want Allah to find me where He doesn't love me to be. And therefore, I am going to become the doorman, the guard of my heart. And the more the consciousness of Allah is in me, experientially now, through my qalb that Allah is watching me, the more able and capable I will be in becoming the doorman to my heart. And we have to undertake this journey of consciousness, of awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when we're confronted with challenges in the external world, those challenges at my nafsi level are, if you like, emotional challenges, shahawat, or carnal desires, or ahwa, philosophical desires, philosophical inclinations. Those are powerful impulses of the nafs. When you had a desire to eat something, or a desire to do something, you feel it inside. It's a powerful call inside of you. And even when we have ideas that are not in harmony with what Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam want, we are attached to those ideas at a nafsi level, and they're strong inside of us. Now when those shahwat, those carnal desires of the nafs, meaning material desires of the nafs, base material desires, and those ideological, philosophical desires, when they rise up when they well up inside of me, and when they want me to follow them and to actualize them, it's almost impossible, if not very difficult if not impossible, to mentally fight that battle. Are you with me? Let's say I have a strong desire, give me one. Strong, give me an example of a strong carnal desire.
Overeating.
Good example, iftar. Right, we're all, this is a universal example. So, when iftar time comes, so Mawlana Khalil, he mentioned that it's very true, that's one of the most dangerous times when we fast. One of the most perilous times is iftar time. Because the whole idea of Ramadan and Sawm was, and honestly, وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي, I'm speaking to my own self, يَعْلَمُ اللَّهُ, that the whole idea of Sawm was to restrain myself, was to control myself at that level and at other levels, to control my mind, to control my heart, to fast with my mind, to fast with my heart, and then to fast with my lips. Then the food is placed in front of me and I feel that strong shahwa to eat and eat and eat and eat. And if I give license to that shahwa at that time, then I'm breaking my fast. Are you with me? I'm breaking the fast. I'm breaking the spirit of Sawm. I broke it. Legally, it is halal. But at the spiritual level, I've broken the fast. I've broken it. I've lost the spirit of Siyam because I've given it to a strong channel. Now, when that happens, right? Does your mind say to your nafs now, because the nafs really wants to eat soup, bean curry, what do you call that? The cook sisters, the donuts, which by the way are not donuts. Donuts have a hole in it.
Three donuts.
Right? We had this debate at the Dharma room once. The asatida were debating, does the donut have a hole or does the donut not have a hole? And those who were from North America, they said, that's the origin of donut land. That's the asal of donuts. It definitely has a hole. Then I remember Mulad Mu'az saying, it does not. The asal of donuts is here, get down. It's long, it's not round, number one, it doesn't have a hole. So then he Googled it. And he said, when he typed in donut, it came out of donut with no hole. And he said, you know, that's the hujjah. I've broken your argument through Mufti Google. Now, when that powerful desire wells up in me, right? It's difficult, it's not impossible for now, mentally, intellectually, for me to say, excuse me, nafs, can you just hold on for a few minutes? You know? I think you should take a back seat here. Why don't you work with me? Let's come to a compromise. Right? Because the shahwa is strong. And at a mental level, usually we cannot encumber. We can't bring in the shahwa. At the qalbi level, if the emotion and the connection to Allah Azza wa Jal is strong at the qalbi level, then that deals with that nafsi drive much easier. It's like there is a battle of inner emotions, a nafsi experience and a qalbi experience. And if the qalbi conscientious consciousness and awareness and experience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is watching me and I feel that in my qalb. I have haya for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have ta'azim, I have reverence. I have reverence and deep respect in my qalb as a feeling for the fast. Then on the scale, on the balance, when that one is stronger, and usually the qalbi experience, if one has it, is stronger. Because the qalb is not like the nafs, it's of a higher dimension. The nafs is attached to material things. It's attached to base material realities. The qalb is attached to heavenly realities. And therefore its experience is not a four-dimensional experience. It is a multi-dimensional experience more than that. And therefore it has a greater experience and a greater emotional experience. So when that's stronger, that envelops the other one. It diminishes the other one very easily. And therefore this journey of muraqabah has to be with the intent of connecting my qalb to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, spiritually, emotionally, experientially. Now, if I don't, yesterday was being the dormant of my heart, which to a certain extent is a consequence of muraqabah. What about the consequences if I don't do muraqabah? If I'm not in that awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala watching me. And remember, hafidhakumullah, we're speaking about muraqabah in a non-technical sense, not the specific sort of muraqabah, but just that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching inside of my qalb. So what if I don't do it? Or if I become lax in it? Okay, here's the story. We were traveling, some of us, with one of our teachers, and we were traveling in the Islamic city, the Islamic country of Morocco. And we were in one of the famous cities in Morocco. It used to be an imperial city in the old days, the seat of governance and power. And in that city, I think it was Marrakesh, in that city, there is a famous tourist attraction. It's a promenade. It's a huge walkway. And families come and they walk and picnic and play. And we went to visit that and we were walking and it was built in the olden times. So as we're walking down the promenade, one of the brothers is telling us, you know, what it used to be like in the old days. And he says that the rulers in the olden times, the Muslim rulers, they built it. And they built on either side of it a beautiful garden. A beautiful garden. Different trees, different flowers. And in those days it was a sight to behold. It was grand. And then this promenade through that. And even, subhanAllah, our ancestors and our early teachers, they knew what brings peace and quiet to the qalb. Even to build that for the general public, you know, a beautiful open space, and then to reflect as you walk through that, so many meanings of a sirat with you, with your family, and on either side there's beauty in different ways, natural beauty to engender, to encourage the mind and heart to be in dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jalla, to be in tafakkur, to be in tadabbur of what's around you. So, in the olden days, so then the sheikh, he walks off the path. So we follow him, we're all walking together now. And as he walks off the path, of course today there's no guard there. That was in the old days. Today there's just weeds. Trees that don't have any flowers. Shrubs, foliage, sand, grass here and there. So as we walk off the path, he turns to us and he says, you know, This used to be a garden one day. Used to be a garden. And look what has happened to him. And in Allah's natural world, there's a natural law. We already looked at one of them, the law of potential energy. That when I struggle for Allah Azza wa Jal, I build up potential energy. In the same way that happens in the physical world, I build up spiritual potential energy to help me keep the challenges and difficulties of life. There's another law in the natural world, the law of entropy. The law of entropy says that whenever you have a closed system, that system naturally becomes more disorderly with the passage of time. It naturally becomes more disorganized, becomes more chaotic with the passage of time, unless there is an external force outside of that system imposing order on that system to keep it orderly and to keep it organized. That's the second law of thermodynamics, law of entropy. Now this law, all of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's laws have parallels. The ones in the natural world, they have parallels at the spiritual world. So he said that garden, that's an example of the law of entropy. That garden is an example of the law of entropy. Because those who were tending it, they were tending it, they were cultivating, they were planting it. They were undertaking its maintenance. If you ever drive by a beautiful garden here in Cape Town, you think no one's working on that? There's probably, in some neighborhoods, probably 1, 2, 3 gardeners to do that. And to keep maintaining it, and to keep planting, to keep taking out the weeds, to keep it trimmed, to keep it clean, right? To prune the trees, to make sure there's no insects, harmful insects, to harm the flowers, to harm the trees. They're doing that all the time, but we don't see that. So then he looked at us, and he said, so it is with the qalb. So it is with the qalb. If we are not imposing order on the qalb, ensuring that we are, for example, to be the doormen and doorwomen of our heart, if we're not constantly doing that, then the garden inside of us will turn to this. Now I remember that very powerfully because he said the garden inside of us will become this, and if we allow it to be like that, then there may come a time when you can't make it into a garden again. When the hearts become like stones, and that was mentioned, when the hearts become like rocks, they become too hard. If we keep leaving them like that, then the garden inside of us, the orchard inside of us, of the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attributes and the beautiful virtues and akhlaq, they become like a weed garden. They become like a desolate, even desert. And I remember that because when he was looking at us, he looked directly at one of us and said, beware that your garden does not become like this. And what does Riyad mean? Riyad means gardens. Rawla, Riyad, plural, means gardens. So, my dear brothers and sisters, if we are not consciously guarding our hearts, being in muraqabah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in whichever specific way, then what will take place in me is spiritual entropy, moral entropy. And there is no steady state here. I should understand that. There is no, if I leave my qalb, it stays the way it is. That's not the law of entropy. If we leave this room and no one cleans it for a year, actually, where I am in the Hif Madrasa, I have a small room. That's like the perks of being the oldest student at the Hif Madrasa. I get my own room. So every Friday, I look around to see if I should clean it. Every Friday morning, it's not the Jumu'ah, the day of Jumu'ah, my room has a haq over me as I see it. So I try to do a clean up. And what I notice is, it's winter, so my windows are, for the most part, closed. There's always dust. Always dust. And it amazes me. Just 7 days pass. Right? Usually I have the windows closed because it's cold, but there's always dust over the sink. And I always have to roll up my sleeves and wash it and spray it and clean it. And it amazes me that that's what happens naturally. And I always think, it always reminds me of the law of entropy. That is, if I don't do anything, I'm getting cursed. If I don't make an effort, I'm getting worse. If I don't struggle, I'm getting worse. And if you look at it this way, it's a type of a spiritual drift that's happening. I'm starting to drift now. You know, if you can imagine yourself in a body of water, and if you, and you know, you want to stay close to the shore, the safety of the shore, and if you're not making an effort to be sure the shore is there, I'm going to be here, the current starts to take you, the natural currents. And you start to drift. And if you drift for a few days, or weeks, or months, suddenly you're far out to sea and the shore is nowhere to be seen. And the shore is nowhere to be found. And sometimes we have that experience where we wake up spiritually and realize what happened. You know, what did I do? What just happened to me? How did I say that? How did I do that? Boy and girl, something happens that shouldn't happen. And then, I'm going to use the sister here. The sister says, I don't know what happened. Yes, you do. How did it happen? There was a process that happened. And we were unaware of the process. You were unaware of the process of how it happens. You weren't focusing on Allah Azza wa Jal, on the qalb, on working to keep it orderly. And it could start with something very simple and maybe sometimes even very, perhaps, apparently innocent. The boy tells the girl, you know, sister, you know, you're a hafidah, mashallah. I'm having trouble with my makharij. You know, how do you say, I just, ba, you know, ba is, I'm a Westerner, ba is like, you know, the letter in the Arabic language, the most difficult one that is not found in many other languages. So how do you say that? Can you help me? Then she says, blah, he says, blah. Then he goes, you know, maybe we could meet perhaps, and there are other maharids that I need to work on, but we meet in public, you know, in front of everyone. Okay, step two, next drift. Then, you know, I've got some questions about tajweed. Maybe we can speak through WhatsApp. Another spiritual drift. And like that, like that, like that. So where we find ourselves is the result of our spiritual drift. Especially when those are situations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not love. So that essentially is the focus for today. And the topic was, you know, cultivate your garden. Cultivate your garden. And cultivate because it has to be an active, external effort whereby you impose order on yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the amana that the mountains didn't want. And that amana is choice. His choice, his will, irada. And that irada we have, and we can't abrogate it, we can't arrogate it. You know, we can't simply claim, and we live in a society where that's what we're told. We're constantly told conflicting things. We're told that, you know, we are a rational society, scientific society. You know, we don't believe in superstitions and religions. We're told that on one hand, but never in the history of humankind has our society been more driven by its nafsi desires, its nafsi passions. Never in the history of humankind, of civilization, has a society, our secular modern society, be so driven by nafsi drives and inclinations. And oftentimes, our excuse is, I can't control my heart. I can't control my feelings. I can't control my heart, it just happened. The heart wants what it wants. Notwithstanding that we're living in a society that preaches, you know, rationality and it preaches reason. So, unfortunately, we don't have an excuse. Because yes, we can control, to a great extent, what happens in our hearts by being the dormant to our hearts. The reason why we can't control that, and the reason why it becomes uncontrollable, is because we've abdicated that position. We haven't imposed upon ourselves to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have imposed upon ourselves to be the dormant of our hearts. And we don't let in what Allah ta'ala doesn't allow it to be. What Allah doesn't want to be in our room. Khairan. That's it for today. If there's any, perhaps, any comments or reflections, I wanted to do that, inshallah, but unfortunately, your comments, your reflections are very valuable. And definitely I can learn from them, and definitely we can all learn from them. Any questions or comments about what we've been studying, for example, or perhaps your experiences? Khairan, inshallah. Sheikh Al-Azhar is saying that why don't we sit for muraqabah for 10 minutes and then perhaps we can have a discussion for half an hour or so after that. Reflections or comments or your experiences. Alhamdulillah, it's good to share them. It's good to share them because sometimes, oftentimes, what I'm experiencing and what I'm going through is what others are as well. And oftentimes, alhamdulillah, Allah Ta'ala shows me something, teaches me something that can benefit others. So let's inshallah, let's sit for 10 minutes. That's 5 minutes more. 5 minutes more, inshallah. And 10 minutes is good, alhamdulillah. We sit and remind myself that, you know, I'm sitting, I'm gathering all of my internal energies, my focus, my will, my resolution, my hopes, my fears, my love, on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Feeling that Allah ta'ala is near, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching inside of my qalb, direct the gaze of my heart to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to bring to mind istihbara, to bring to mind Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's perfection, Allah azza wa jalla's majesty, Allah's beauty, Allah's greatness, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-azim, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-jaleel, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-qudus, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-akbar, greater, greater, greater. Allah ta'ala is al-kabir, but Allahu akbar, Allah is greater than anything that rises up, that comes inside of me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Akbar.